So I think words like this are what make relationship what they are, right? Always good to hear so many good things about yourself in the just 2-3 minutes, and that energizes you. So it's been about 5 months into this lockdown, and let me ask you all, what is that thing that you miss the most during this period of the lockdown? Just go for it.
I miss meeting my friends and hanging out with them.
Absolutely. What else?
Working out in the gym.
Working out in the gym, something that you miss. And it's not just working out, it's about also making connections, right, Amol?
If I was an active member, I would miss coming to Mekon for the club meetings.
Absolutely. Working, I mean, coming to Mekon for these meetings. I've stayed off this meeting because I find this online mode so sterile and cold, so I've not been coming. It's a real flesh and blood relationships at Toastmasters that make you want to come. But nevertheless, we have to adapt to this so-called new normal, right? So this pandemic has reshaped our personal relationships in unprecedented ways. When I asked this question, what people miss the most, somebody had to say, I miss those crispy Vidyarthi Bhavan dosas. Eating it there, there's nothing like that, right? So somebody else said traveling or hanging out with friends. So I think all of us miss much the same things. When I meet my friends for after a long period of time, post-lockdown, I reach out my arms in this big hug. But suddenly it freezes in mid-air because we're supposed to be socially distancing ourselves, right? So then I get down to, okay, let's do a high five. And then of course, I make minimal contact here with a high five, but I immediately reach out for my sanitizer and just clean up my hands. That somehow just kills it all, kills all the intimacy that you feel with a high five that we give, right? So relationships of all kinds have changed. The way we meet people, the way we greet people, everything about these relationships have changed. And I think today's session, I want to focus on just this, how our relationships have changed and what can we do to revitalize these relationships in these stay-at-home times. Now I see that there are 53 participants almost here in this session tuned in, and this is a virtual relationship that is happening in real time. I want to tell you this little incident. My 92-year-old father has to go in for dialysis every week. His hearing loss is almost 100%. Hearing aids don't help. We use only the sign language to communicate. He watches TV with those scrolls passing by, just reading through it and getting information. Is quite tuned in to what is happening around in the world. Then he keeps telling me, why don't you write to these TV fellows to slow down those scrolls, let them be there, because I want to at least be able to read it. Add to this lockdown and the whole feeling of isolation, because he's in this vulnerable stage with his immunity compromised. And for his own sake and for the other's sake, the family members maintain very little contact with him. And even just about, you know, maintaining this 1 meter distance while talking to him doesn't help because he can't hear. And on my weekly visits to visit him, a nice warm hug expressed so much that words couldn't say. And his eyes would just light up. But now I can't even do that, again, for my own sake or for his more than mine. I think in today's times, communication has been downgraded, right? With all the technology that is available to us, yes, we can communicate with each other, but the heart and soul of communication is taken off, right? So I say thank God for these digital conversations that we're able to have and Zoom sessions like this. But it's so sterile and cold, isn't it? So relationships at my home, all of you may be agreeing with the same. With my students in college, I no longer like these online classes because all the time we're saying, can you please switch on your video? Can I see your face? And things like that. So most of our time goes in just giving these instructions, which we don't even know people are listening to. So everybody says connectivity issues and whatever. And I can't see anybody face to face. And that completely takes the life out of communication for me. So it's devoid of life. And I'm sure each one of you have several instances of the same kind. In the process of physical and social distancing, emotions which anchor this whole huge ship called relationships is somehow being misplaced out of its central location, if I may say. Now, can I ask you this question? What happens to all these unexpressed emotions and unfelt emotions?
It bottles up in the subconscious mind.
Just remains in your subconscious mind?
Yeah.
I want to hug you, but I can't hug you. So I just retract, go back in reverse mode. What happens to that hug?
Frustration.
I can't reach out and complete that act. And you don't feel the emotion that I am trying to convey, right? So today I thought it relevant to link communication, the heart of Toastmasters, to the art of revitalizing these relationships in these stay-at-home times. It is one of the deepest hopes for me that for many of us, we can use this time to set this giant reset button on our relationships. Slow down and develop meaningful relationships to reinvent and revitalize our relationships. I think our future depends on it, right? Relationships are taking the whole strain of this pandemic in ways that are unexplainable. Most of us believe that relationships will just work. Do they just work just like that? It's a work in progress, right?
No.
It doesn't work. So it's a work in progress that is constantly happening. So I believe that this lockdown can go two ways. It could suddenly mean we're spending too much time with some people and not having too much time with some others, right? Too much time with some people and too less with some others. Would you agree with me on that? So people in homes or stay-at-home moms and people who are working from home, I think, let me take the first of these two options, like spending too much time with each other. So we have older adults, we have parents, adolescents, younger children. Often there are generations living together under the same roof, right? And romantic partners who suddenly find they're spending too much time with each other, right? So it can be either that you're spending too much time or too little time if it's a long distance relationship. Now that is why you find in these lockdown times, suddenly there are too many weddings happening. Right? Suddenly you feel that don't know when this pandemic is going to end, we better hitch up and start living our life together, right? So we're spending too much time in the same space. Now going away to school or work meant that time away from family for over 8 to 10 hours. Being in your own space, now it's finally home at all times. So the other day I had a very agitated mother calling me up and saying, listen, can I talk to you? Because I'm having problems with my teenager who's in her 10th standard. She is sleeping all the time. She has online classes from 7:30 to 12:30. And from 12:30 to 4:30, she sleeps. And then the rest of the time, she's on her mobile again. I ask her to go out to the neighborhood and socialize, but she doesn't want to do that. And I'm worried because she doesn't shower, take her shower the regular times of the day. She wakes up, sleep and wake cycles are all over the place. And she was suddenly wondering, do you think this kind of behavior needs attention? Is the problem with my teenage daughter, or is it me and my overworked mind? What do you think it is? The agitated, over-protective and over-micromanaging her child, the mother's problem, or the child's problem?
A combination of everything.
Combination of everything, right? Too much time being spent with each other, and you've never seen so much of each other, right? So,
madam, I have a slightly different experience. Can I express, madam?
Yes, please.
My daughter work at home, stays more than 12 hours in her room only, working with various customers, and though she is in the house, rarely talks to us. Always in the computer and telephone, and never comes outside. I don't know.
So what happens in these times when this happens? Everybody's tempers are fraying. How do you deal with it? Anybody else facing similar problems?
Cooperate with inevitable.
Cooperation is inevitable. Anybody from the other side, the teenagers, adolescents?
I think it's now like we've got to do it. I think even we clock more than 10, 12 hours a day, and it becomes a part of your work cycle. And earlier you would come back and log in. So now you save those 2-3 hours of journey, 2-3 hours of travel. And I think sometimes if work demands, we would as well give it that time. I wouldn't say stretch it, but give it the necessary time.
Give whom the necessary time, your child or yourself?
Work, I think.
the work, yeah.
So, Dr. V, I have a different point of view.
Yes, please.
So when, this is Vijay here. When March started, it is like a team forming. So we had the forming stage, then we have a very bad storming stage.
Right.
And we come somewhere in the norming stage at the moment. And that performing is still to happen somewhere. Maybe if we are still doing this after a year, hopefully we'll get there. But that's where we are.
Yep.
But in the sense, we kind of started getting used to the way things are.
Right.
But we're getting there. But yes, one thing I have realized, I've started working less.
Okay.
And whatever little bit of work I do, I try to finish it off in lesser time.
Okay. So does that help with your relationships, Vijay?
Yes, it does. I managed to spend more quality time with my family.
So this quality time has got a whole new definition today.
Yes.
Right?
So initially that quality time was, as you said, they cross a lot of friction because you don't see each other so much every day. Now you do.
Right. So, but I'm not too sure your wife has the same opinion, Vijay.
Well, I've started helping out Dr. V, so she does look at it in a more, how do you say it, in a good way.
But I think a lot of homemakers are feeling suffocated because everybody is at home all the time and the kitchen is open. Okay, sorry. So this is what is happening in the digital lockdown that we are. People and chaos is happening all around you. So while you're at work, there is a pressure cooker going off. There are people talking in the background and you're trying to focus on work, and there's so much of tension in the air. So there's too much happening at the same time, right? So a good section of teenagers today, I realize, are beginning to like this lazy, laid-back lifestyle that they're leading. I've been asking around a few teenagers and say, do you want to go back to normal school and college? And they say, no, I'm quite happy this way. You're getting used to it. Because everything is happening you've designed your own space and everything is happening within that. You feel that you don't want to go back to that classroom situation. So this is adapting in a way, but not quite the right way, I must say. So we are compelled to be in each other's company, and ultimately everybody needs their own space. I think this is very, very vital in today's times. So homemakers were very happy having their own, their kingdom, as they would call it, while people left home. At least the homemaker was looking forward to some quiet time during the day. But this is not happening now. Working professionals have realized that they've realized that working from home, they're confused whether they're working from home or working for home and working at home. Like, I have to do the mopping. Everybody has to help with the household work. So working from home and the workplace and home, the lines are blurring, right? So, and home, your family members don't make for great work colleagues, do they? I don't think so. So everybody is logging into different systems all at the same time, and we don't really quite know what is happening. This work from home option, which sounded very fancy some time ago, is not really as fancied today. So 1 week after working from home, one of the father's biggest takeaway, which I heard from one of my friend's father, he just got down to say, after 1 week of being in this lockdown, I believe my children's teacher needs a raise. Agree with that? Right? I can't manage these kids at home all day, and I think she definitely needs a raise. So, and I believe that today, the tension in the homes are rising so much that if the schools are closed for too long now, the parents are going to find a vaccine before the scientists do. Right? And I think their motivation is the highest. So living rooms have become war zones, conflict zones. Arguments are plenty. And for example, we run a toll-free helpline for psychosocial counseling. And in recent times, there have been so many calls and complaints of domestic abuse. You're finding people too much, spending too much time with each other. And the domestic abuse has risen tenfold, they say. So as for romantic relationships, people isolating with their partners are probably not used to this amount of time that they're spending with each other, right? As people's romantic lives, work lives, and domestic life, they're all piling on together. And they're getting suffocated and are desperately looking for a way out. I know of people waiting to get a divorce as soon as this lockdown is lifted and courts begin working. So even couples that have been happily married for 20 plus years are experiencing this phenomena. It's much like when one of the spouses or both of the partners retire from an active work life, they no longer look forward to the time spending time together, right? So there is a lot of what we call as relationship turbulence. Now, times like this tell us that togetherness is not always good, and separation is not always bad. How many of you agree with that, right? Togetherness is not always good, and separation is not always bad, right? So relationships, I believe, are like mutual funds. Like they say, your investments are subject to market risks. Please read the offer document carefully before investing, right? So before these relationships go out of control, I think we have to remember the three R's. So I don't know if those of you who are going through it or know of somebody who's going through it, this is what you want to share with them. So the three R's to maintain these relationships, in my opinion, are routine, I think, is very, very important. So this whole thing of sleeping late, not having a shower, not getting dressed up for work, or the routine is the most therapeutic thing, as most of you would have discovered today. So I think a part of the old normal has to go along with this new normal. A routine, I think, is absolutely essential to keep ourselves sane and sensible. So that is my first R. That is, we have to stick to routines in everything. So eating of nutritious meals and not snacking and gorging on unhealthy food at all times of the day or night. If you're working long hours, it doesn't mean you can be eating at all times. So have a routine on your sleep-wake cycles, on your eating habits, all of that. Secondly, I think the most important one is to respect boundaries, right? So each other's space, I think, is very, very important. Though you're in the same house, in the same home, you want to be able to do things independently from each other. So don't take this togetherness too seriously. Don't spend too much of time with each other, more than what is natural for you. So I think the immediate solution for this is to give yourself more space to breathe, make time to attend to your own needs. Maybe if you want to take a walk, I think if people are imprisoned, the lockdown seems to have imprisoned a lot of people and they're afraid to go out home. So now I think it's 5 months down the line. It's time to shrug off this whole feeling of being cooped up inside the house and venture out a bit while still maintaining all the precautions. So you've got to have your masks on, don't go to crowded places, follow social distancing, but do make sure that you're stepping out for some time during the day, giving yourself space from your family members. The third one would be to reconnect within the family in small doses. Again, here I would say don't overdo it. There are some people I say, okay, let's spend time together. Let's have all our meals together. Let's play Ludo. Let's play whatever, all those games that you want to. So it's okay when you go out on a holiday and everybody is doing their own thing. But here, reconnecting or movie times and meals and all of that needs to be in a kind of a measured way rather than overdoing it. So this is about having too much company or spending too much time with each other. And I think these are 3 R's you want to remember: the routine, the respecting your boundaries, and reconnecting, but in small doses, right? So lockdown also means social and physical distancing, wearing a mask, all of that. But what happens to these romantic relationships? We are all so accustomed to being demonstrative, right, in our romantic relationships, giving each other a warm hug, holding hands, just taking a bite off somebody else's burger, for example. Now there's a total deprivation of physical affection, right? And this is a real problem. Recently, I became a grandmother, okay? My grandson is almost going to be 2 months old, and I haven't been able to go and meet and hold this precious joy bundle in my hands. Corey Floyd, a professor at the University of Arizona, describes this deprivation. I was looking for this word of something that would express my feelings. I'm not able to hold my grandchild in my hands. Okay. Now, this psychologist describes this beautifully. The deprivation of physical affection, she calls it skin hunger. You know, the flesh and blood that you can hold and feel the warmth of a hug, or an intimate gesture. So being able to talk to somebody over a phone or on a video call is not half as fulfilling as doing it in the real sense, right? So today, how do we overcome this deprivation of physical affection, physical contact? How do we maintain this emotional connect in these times of social distancing? I want to share with you a new language. I know some of you may have heard about it, some of you may not have. This holds the key to long-lasting relationships. It can be used in the toughest of situations. It's called the love language. Okay, now there's an American author and psychologist who came up with this. I'm sure all of us do it, but we don't know this as a love language. But this person called Gary Chapman said, you need to use a separate kind of a love language. Identify that love language with which you respond to each other. And that is what is the key to a lasting relationship. So are you all interested in knowing what this love language is? are you keen on picking that up and using it in your romantic or any other relationship, right? So, so when I say this love language can be used with partners, it's not just romantic partners, but it can be the way you deal with your child, the parent-child relationship, the boss-employee relationship, any relationship at all for that matter, right? So the first of this love language is called words of affirmation, right? So you want to tell people that you appreciate them and that you admire what they're doing, compliment them. We do a lot of this in Toastmasters, right? So words of affirmation are very, very important for people. Like, for example, I would say simple things like, thanks for putting the kids to bed, for example, okay? So there's a warm glow in the other person when you say this, right? Or thank you for cooking me this delicious meal, for example, right? So these are things that people wait to hear. And that's a love language that best expresses what you're feeling towards the other person. But on the other hand, conversely, insults can be particularly upsetting to people who are looking for these words of affirmation, right? So if you're giving them insults, they'll never forget that. So you want to give them as many positive words of affirmation as you probably can. Okay. So this is your first love language that you can use, words of affirmation. The second one would be gifts. I'm sure all of us like receiving these gifts, right? So these, when I say gifts, it's not just tangible gifts like a bunch of roses or diamonds, but even intangible gifts. What are these intangible gifts you can give people? What is the intangible gifts that you have received from somebody that has made you feel happy?
A smile.
Affection.
A smile, okay.
Appreciating.
Sorry?
Appreciating.
Appreciating. More like a word of, words of affirmation. But something like, you know, favorite chops, a bottle of champagne maybe. These are tangible gifts. Or somebody books you a charming holiday by the beach, for example, an experience, gifting you an experience. So that's like a love language that speaks volumes for some people. Okay, so it seals the deal when you make these kind of gestures of gifting people. Today, the trend is more on gifting people experiences, right? So I give them skydiving experience maybe, or a beach holiday, or whatever it is, or a candlelight dinner in the most fanciest place. All of these are what we would call the gifts that are tangible or intangible. But people who love and appreciate this language of gifts, if you absence of this in their everyday lives, is going to make them very, very unhappy. So if you forget their anniversaries or their birthdays, you had it. If that's the kind of romantic partner you're linked up with, and if you don't use this language that they understand, you had it, right? So take that seriously and be sensitive to what is it the love language that they speak. And if that is the words of affirmation and gifts, the third one is acts of service, right? Doing something helpful and kind for your partner. Like, for example, waking up to attend to a baby's cry during the middle of the night when the mother is really having her much needed sleep, for example. Or during these lockdown times, a lot of men volunteer to do the dishes. Nothing makes a woman happier than somebody lending a hand with the household chores, right? So for someone who favors acts of service, if you are showing any kind of ambivalence or lack of support during these times when they're looking for it, I think it damages relationship like nothing else. So you want to be feeling the pulse of that person and say acts of service. So sometimes the most romantic gesture you can show to a person is vacuuming the house. Yeah. So just saying the words like, I'll do that for you, I'll handle that for you, is something that excites a person so much when you speak that language of doing that act of service. The next love language is quality time, right? So like Vijay was saying, I think he's doing a lot of this quality time love language, Vijay. So engaging in activity, particularly things that you both enjoy doing together? It may be going out for a cycle ride today, because I think the lockdown has made a lot of people buy bicycles and go off cycling, right? So yeah, it's about just doing those activities together and giving yourself that quality time together. And if this is your love language, if your partner is distant and distracted, then you're definitely going to have problems with your relationship. So if you feel that you're, you know, makes you feel unseen and unheard, I think people really react to it very badly in a relationship. So quality time is very, very essential. And you know, the nice thing or the not so nice thing about this love language is people just expect you to know. I don't want to tell people, you know what, I need appreciation from you. I need compliments from you. You are supposed to understand that, right? Especially women are very unpredictable. Say many, many men don't seem to understand this, that what is it that a woman wants is one of the biggest questions. Like Sigmund Freud was always puzzled with, what is it that women want? Whatever I do doesn't seem to make her happy, right? So they want you to speak the love language that they are most comfortable with. So you want to spend that quality time. And the last of these love languages, the fifth one, is physical touch, right? So physical expressions of love, such as holding hands, just a back scratch, a hug, a kiss. The absence of these expressions can leave these individuals isolated in a relationship, right? So you want to be in sync, whatever it is, whether it's a parent-child or a romantic relationship, the partners need to be in sync with each other when they are speaking this love language. So let me give you an example of this. So there was this man and wife that went out to dinner. The waiter flirts with the woman, but the husband doesn't seem to notice, right? And he's talking very excitedly about wanting to change the oil in her car, right? The wife is very upset because her husband isn't jealous. The waiter is ogling at her and the husband is not jealous. The husband feels that his extra work is not being appreciated, right? So they're both talking very, very different languages. This has to do with love, right? The man and women are defining love in very different ways. For him, love is all about being practical and doing these acts of service and supportive gestures. Whereas for her, it is love is possessive, and a jealous response by her husband makes her feel very valued. So if you're not talking the same love language and you're not in sync, there's trouble brewing, right? So start by thinking, how do you identify what love language? Start by thinking how you like to give and receive love. I think that's the easiest way to do it. So when I want to show affection, what do I do? Okay, so, or how do I do it? Do I cook a really nice meal, or maybe send an appreciative text to that person, or maybe buy some concert tickets, maybe? So often the way you express your love can provide clues about what kind of love language you most appreciate, right? I hope all of you are with me on this. Udang, how much time do I have?
Another 5 minutes.
Okay, great. So if you ask me, can sweeping and mopping the floor be an act of love? Absolutely, especially in these lockdown times. So anything you do to ease the burden of somebody else, weighed down with responsibilities, speaks volumes of your love. So just simply saying that, let me do that for you, works great. Next, also think about what makes you feel most loved and cared for, right? So do you feel closest to your partner when they do something helpful, or do you crave physical touch? So speaking the right language to the right person is the key here. So if I have to just repeat those five love languages: words of affirmation, gifts, quality time, what else? Acts of service, and of course the physical gestures. So if you haven't been doing much of these already, I hope, especially in these times, you invest more time into revitalizing your relationships, and this is the language you can speak. Toastmasters is all about making a good communication, right? So communication is not always through simply words, but you can learn a new language and practice this for good effect. So if you haven't already done this, or if you're doing it the wrong way, I hope I've given you some tips on how to reconnect with your partners, respect your boundaries, and make these little use of this love language, identify your own, identify your that of your partner. What is it that the spouse or the child responds to best? And that would really rejuvenate your relationships. This is like, relationships are like an emotional bank account, right? They often speak of a ratio called the 5:1. So 5 positive gestures and 1 negative gesture. So that's the kind of ratio you want to maintain in your emotional bank account. So the deposits and the withdrawals, both of them equally important. Relationships, they say, is all about giving, right? So most often they say when you want to have a good friend, you have to be that good friend. So it's about giving, and automatically there's something that comes back to you. So on that note, I think I'd like to wind this up by saying, invest in your relationships. It'll never go waste. Will always help you reap rich rewards, and you will never ever regret in investing in a relationship bond. I think that should be the most preferred investment of your day at any time in your life. This is the ship that will anchor you. Over to you, Master of Ceremonies.